With close to 3,000 horsepower, Sal's Dodge Viper is currently the second fastest rear-wheel drive car across the half mile at 234 mile an hour. On top of this, it's also run as quick as a 696 at 215 mile an hour in the quarter, all while being street legal. Now, power is one thing, but managing that power and getting it to the track is really the key to these sort of times and numbers. So we're here with Chris Delgado from ProSpeed to find out a little bit more about this car and the tuning behind it. So Chris, let's start with the power package. Now, the Dodge Viper is not maybe that well known in these top speed events, and the availability of aftermarket parts is maybe a little bit more limited, particularly when it comes to the engine block. There aren't the availability of aftermarket billet blocks. So can you tell us about the engine fitted to this? What's been done to it to make it reliable up around those 3,000 horsepower levels?
It's a factory block. It's basically a piston rod setup, 9-to-1 compression ratio. It's a 540 cubic inch, so it's slightly larger than factory.
Now, for those who work in Metro, that's close to 9 litres, so it's a big capacity engine. Also, for those not familiar with the Dodge Viper, it is a V10, so it's 10 cylinders.
Correct. Steve Drummond actually did all the engine work on it. They've put a lot of time and energy into working out all the issues early on they had, and they've, you know, I don't know all the little tips and tricks that they've got going on in there, but they've definitely been able to make it pretty reliable at the power levels that it's at now.
Now, in terms of the power per cylinder, being that it is a V10, the specific power level per cylinder is perhaps not as high as we may expect on a typical V8, but still for a stock block, it's getting very, very high. And one of the aspects here, because the factory block is an alloy block, generally we don't get the reliability or integrity in the cylinders, so I understand this engine block has been fitted with sleeves to improve the strength there.
Yeah, it is a Darton sleeve block, and one of the other common things that they do on these is they'll run like a steel main cap as well.
So, and that steel main cap just improves the reliability for the main bearings and holds the crankshaft a little bit more securely.
Correct, yes.
And in terms of that crankshaft, that is another area where the engine is modified. I understand it's also running an aftermarket crank.
Yeah, I believe it's a Velasco, something like that, yeah.
Now, the engine really is there just to remain reliable. The key to actually making the power, though, of course, is getting the airflow into the engine, and that's where the turbochargers come in. So can you tell us what turbos are fitted?
It has some pretty old Gen 1 Precision 91s. I believe they're cast wheels even. I don't think it's even a billet compressor, but you know, the car makes so much power so easily, there really hasn't been a reason to upgrade to a newer, more efficient turbo yet.
Now, also talking to Sal before this interview, the packaging on the Viper is problematic. I mean, it's a naturally aspirated engine from factory, so there isn't a huge amount of room there for turbos. And that upgrade from the five-year-old technology of the turbos on it now to the current Gen 2 ProMod turbos, the ProMod Gen 2s are a much bigger turbo, so that creates a problem with fitment, yes?
Yeah, definitely. They're very tightly fit in there, and pretty sure that we wouldn't be able to fit the newer ones in the same location. It would definitely require some extra modification to make it work.
Now, you've talked about a 9-to-1 compression ratio, so straight away that sounds like it's running on a gasoline-based fuel. Can you tell us what the fuel is?
Up until this weekend, it's been primarily on C16. Because of the duration of the half-mile run and the kind of cylinder temperatures and things that we see, we decided to start switching it over to VPM port. It's a little bit more tolerant fuel, and we just feel more comfortable running it with this kind of load on the engine.
So the difference between those, you've said it's more tolerant, is there an octane rating difference between the C16 and the import?
Yeah, C16 is 116-ish. VPM port, I believe the effective octane when you add all the oxygenation and all the extra stuff is like the 126 to 128 range, so significantly higher.
And the other thing you've just mentioned there is the oxygen content. So some of these race fuels do have their own oxygen, essentially chemically included in the fuel. Mm-hmm. So on these sort of fuels, when we switch to them, we tend to make more power even at the same sort of boost levels. That's fair?
Yes, correct. And they typically will need more fuel even. We had to add about 7% more fuel yesterday to get it back in line with the new fuel. So.
Now, in terms of running on some of these gasoline-based fuels, C16 VP import, intercooling is an essential aspect as opposed to some of the methanol fuel cars where the methanol does pull a lot of heat out of the combustion charge. So can you talk us through the intercooling setup on the car?
Yeah, it's just got one big core in the front. It's got an ice tank in the back. Usually, the thing is the engine doesn't really require a lot of actual pressure ratio to make power because it's so big. So the air temps typically don't get really high until we really start pushing the boost level. So like yesterday on our 229 pass, I think the highest air temp we saw was about 135-ish Fahrenheit.
So again, for those who are more familiar with degrees centigrade, 135 is about 57, I believe. So, I mean, that's getting up there, but not crazy for the sort of temperatures we could expect from high boost drag engines. And with that system you've just mentioned, it's got an ice tank in the boot. So you've got a water to air intercooler core at the front of the car, and then you're pumping an ice slurry through it. So this is better than an air-to-air intercooler for this particular event because you can pull the temperatures down lower, plus you don't have the downside of the aerodynamic drag.
Yeah, that's the main advantage, is because the whole front of the car, in order to make it more slippery through the air, you can see through it, but it's actually blocked off. It's a piece of plexiglass, so there's no air going through the radiator, or if there was an air-to-air, there would just be no air going through it. So in this situation, the air-to-water is definitely the way to go.
I've talked about those turbos and a little bit about boost, but let's talk about exactly how much boost the engine is taking in order to make those sort of 2800 horsepower plus levels. What are you using?
When he was running quarter mile, to make that kind of power, it was around 34, 35 pounds of boost. Yesterday to go 229, we were only around 24. Today we're probably going to be approaching 30 on the first round, and then maybe even higher than that, depending on how the traction looks and the, you know, how the car reacts out there today.
Now, again, for those viewing, obviously by the time this video comes out, things could have changed, but it's already gone 234 mile an hour. The current world record is 236.1, so you're incredibly close. The fact that you've just done that with that 229 pass with only 24 PSI bodes pretty well for the rest of this event, so we're definitely keen to see how that goes. But of course, it's not as simple as just winding up the wick, making more power, turning the boost up. It's all about getting that power to the track. So can you tell us how you're monitoring that progress and how you're delivering the boost as the car goes down the track? I'm assuming that you're not just feeding it 30 pounds straight off the line.
No. We do pay a lot of attention to Excel G and tire speed, and the difference in tire speed between the front and rear.
And so it's essentially measuring slip or traction for traction
right.
control purposes too?
We're looking at slip, and we're looking at how much slip and how the slip relates to the acceleration of the vehicle. For instance, yesterday we've been really focusing on the first 300 or 400 feet of the run because that's where we have the most issue. The engine is kind of like a light switch. It's either like on or off, and trying to really control that from a dead stop, especially at altitude here, has been a little bit of a challenge. So mainly, like today, we came in and we looked, we're like, okay, well, yesterday we had, you know, some tire speed here, you know, up here, the Excel G started dropping off, the tire speed was good, there was no slip, we can put a lot more power, you know, and the goal is really just to try to get the best acceleration possible within the limits of the tire slip that will produce the best acceleration. So
in order to get it to hook up for those first 300 to 400 feet, what sort of boost level are you actually leaving the line with?
Leaves the line on wastegate. It's really only making about 4 or 5 pounds of boost when it leaves. And then once it gets about 300 feet out, then it starts to ramp up pretty aggressively.
Now, sometimes that can be a real problem as well, getting a wide spread of boost levels. If we want to run as low as 5 PSI, often that will end up limiting the ultimate boost that we can get out of the wastegate due to the spring. Basically, the back pressure in the exhaust manifold just physically pushes the wastegate open. So how are you getting from as low as 5 through to 35, 40 plus?
The ProEFI has built-in CO2 boost control, and that allows us to basically go from the spring, we could put a 1 pound spring if we wanted to, and allows us to go up to basically clamping the wastegate shut, and it will make as much boost as the turbo will make.
So with that system, instead of being reliant on the boost pressure the engine's making to be able to supply that to the top of the wastegate to force it closed, you're using regulated CO2. So you could, instead of 5 PSI, you could be supplying 10, 20, 80 or 150 PSI even to the top of the wastegate to clamp it closed?
Correct, exactly.
Now, you've mentioned that ProEFI, so let's delve into that a little bit. So this is the ECU controlling the engine, and what functions over and above the normal fuel and ignition delivery, as well as boost control we've just talked about, are you using in the ProEFI?
The main one that we rely on out here the most is the traction control. Obviously, it's very hard to manage power on a surface that has no grip, essentially, compared to, you know, what we're used to running. So ProEFI has a pretty good traction control. It's probably one of my favorite out of all the other engine managements I deal with. It primarily relies on ignition retard, which makes it extremely fast. Some of the other systems rely more on ignition cuts. And while that works pretty well, it's a little bit less granular than ignition, because if you have 10 cylinders and let's say each cylinder is making 200 horsepower or 150 horsepower and you cut that one cylinder for one cycle, that's a pretty big change in torque applied to the tire. So with ignition retard, you can have a lot more of a gradual decrease in power, and it's a little bit more controllable, a little bit more granular in certain situations.
Yeah, that's been my experience, is that retard is quite a nice way of quickly reducing the engine torque. But of course, in a turbocharged engine, this can be problematic, and it becomes walking a bit of a tightrope. On one hand, retarding the timing will reduce engine torque, but the upshot of this as well is we produce a lot more heat in the exhaust manifold, which in turn can actually be counterproductive because it can spool the turbo, making more boost, obviously the last thing we want. So is there a limit to how much retard you're using before you switch into ignition cutting?
Yeah, we do monitor. We monitor EGTs, and we watch closely the boost level and how the turbos react when it's on traction control, and we kind of find that sweet spot where there's enough control with retard to where it doesn't overboost the turbos, and then we start introducing cuts past that point if we need more. Ideally, you know, the goal is to not have to use a traction control at all, and that doesn't make, you know, the problem's eliminated. So
that's what I was going to just touch on next. I think a lot of people believe that we're tuning a car like this and you're just feeding it all the power it can take, and then just traction control will fix all of your problems down the track. And of course, that's not the situation. We're really trying to deliver a power profile that optimizes the amount of grip available, or uses the amount of grip available at each point in the track. And if we get that right, then we don't need traction control at all. At traction control is only really coming in when something goes wrong. Is that fair?
Yeah, I mean, I tend to rely on the traction control as more of just an upper limit. You know, ideally being on the traction control is not going to be your fastest way down the track, because you're already past kind of the peak of where the tire has ultimate grip. So we definitely want to try to stay underneath that, but it's always there in case we overshoot. And something like this, the track's really bumpy. You know, earlier we talked, you know, we made some suspension changes because at the top of the track, the car was bouncing a little bit, and you could see the wheel speed kind of flicker, and traction control was in and out. So, you know, the traction control kept the car straight and allowed us to make a complete pass, but we can obviously improve on that by making other changes to the vehicle.
Now, the other aspect that sort of goes along with that traction control we've just talked about as well is the power management when the car shifts a gear, and this can often be problematic. Often when the car changes gear, this car's running a power glide, and when the car changes gear, this can often cause the car to lose traction. And the problem with this that a lot of people overlook is once the car actually begins wheel spinning, obviously we've got that traction control there as a safety backstop, but we need to actually reduce the torque a lot more to allow the car to hook back up again, so that obviously hurts the top speed. So can you tell us how you're dealing with torque management through the gear shift?
The ProEFI has basically a gear-based retard, and it actually controls the shifter as well. So it goes in and commands the shift, and then we have a bunch of different parameters we can set up to delay when it pulls the timing, how fast it pulls the timing, how much timing it pulls out, how fast it goes back in. So we're able to really kind of window off that shift and try to reduce torque only at that point where it needs to be reduced to keep the tire from going out of control.
Now, one other aspect I want to talk about on the car is you've got a nitrous system there. So you've already got the ability to make more power than you potentially can put to the track. So nitrous sounds like it's maybe a little bit unnecessary. Can you tell us how you're using that nitrous? Is it sprayed the whole way down the track, or using it just to build boost?
The car actually just recently had nitrous added to it, and this for the sole reason of the altitude. We're at, 6,000 feet here, I believe, somewhere around there?
Even higher.
Is it higher than that? I know it's pretty high, but when we first got here yesterday, we tried to build boost without it just to see what would happen. And it literally did not even get to zero PSI. I mean, it was like still about 90-ish KPA, you know, matted to the floor, 3,000, 3,500 RPM. You could hear the turbos trying to come, but it just wasn't, just not enough, you know, air density here. So the nitrous kind of fills that gap, and it allows us to get the engine going, get the car going, and then once it starts to make a little bit of boost, the nitrous shuts off. So it's only on for maybe 3 to 4 tenths of a second when we first leave, or maybe slightly longer, depending on how much RPM he has when he actually leaves.
So you're again controlling that through the ProEFI based on a boost pressure target to switch it off?
Yeah, we have a bunch of thresholds that have to be has to be within for it to activate and deactivate. But essentially, yeah, as soon as he mats the throttle, it comes on, and then by the time it hits about 5 pounds of boost or so, it shuts off and it's out of the way.
Now, as a tuner, when you've got a car running down a strip like this and it's running to 230 plus mile an hour potentially, there's a lot of things going on, so you're really relying heavily on the data when the car comes back into the pit. So for you, what are the first things that you're looking at in that data before you start looking at improving the car for the next pass?
Generally, I go through all the engine vitals. I'll look at the fuel mixture, I'll look at fuel pressure, I'll look at oil pressure, check the air temps. A lot of people don't look at, you know, we look at back pressure to make sure that we didn't spring any kind of boost leaks or anything during a run, make sure everything looks normal. Once we see all that's good, then we start, looking at things like wheel speed, slip, traction control, and, you know, looking at ways to improve that. We also have shock travel sensors. So this particular timeout, we've paid a lot more attention to the shock stuff because as you start putting more power down, that ability for the suspension to keep the tire planted to the ground becomes more and more important. So it's something that we're focusing on a lot this particular outing as well.
No, that makes a lot of sense, Chris. Look, really interesting to find out what makes this car so fast. You're right on the cusp of a new world record, and you've still got plenty of running left to go this weekend. So we certainly wish you all the best in breaking that 236 mile an hour barrier. Probably still a little bit more difficult than it might sound, but you definitely got a package that seems capable. So all the best, and thanks for the chat, Chris.
Thanks a lot. Appreciate it.
Like that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up, and if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson. You'll learn about performance engine building and EFI tuning, and you'll also have the chance to ask questions which I'll be answering live. Remember, it's 100% free, so follow the link to claim your spot.